Thanks for joining us.
Deadpool. Media for the young and unruly.
We started Organica in 2005. The mission of organic climbing is to build bouldering pads that the customer is really excited about, to have superior customer service, and also to provide jobs for American workers.
Oh, the climbing here is amazing. Some of the best in the world. It might be the best in the world. It's incredible. And the scenery is spectacular. The lines are beautiful. And every problem I've climbed has been world class. It's just awesome. What does bouldering mean to me? Bouldering is just an outlet, I think, for me to live my life through. I expect to climb well and I want to climb well, and that doesn't always happen. I would see myself more as an artist, and climbing is my way of expressing myself. It's like a medium through in which I can express myself.
Jamie, are you proud of that last attempt?
No, not at all. It was horrible. I'm not going to do a boulder problem like that.
It's creative and it's different, and each problem is unique, and I can kind of express myself.
Boom! What the fuck?
I don't feel like I want to feel frustrated all the time, but I feel like I want to feel frustrated and then work through that challenge and then overcome it. I have a hard time doing things quickly. And I know that I can work something and work through it. Mostly when I do boulder problems, they take me a long time. It's just kind of the way it's always been. I really need to feel through things, where it seems like someone like Kevin can just get on it and climb it right away.
My hernia popped out.
What?
What? I have a hernia.
Can you pop it back in?
Wait for it. I just put my intestine back through my abdominal wall.
One of my assets is that I will try and try and try again. Just persevere.
Low balls and high numbers.
If it's a way of life, I feel like there's a more eloquent way to put that, but I don't know what it is. It's definitely
something I can't really see myself not doing, at least not for the next 20 years or something.
Flynn actually broke her own finger rock climbing.
I was in Joe's Valley and noticed some pain and stiffness in my joint. So I went to the doctor and got an x-ray, and they were like, oh, your finger's totally broken. And I managed to put down a few projects.
She's that badass. last year, I had a couple projects that I didn't finish before I left. And one of them is called Last Day in Paradise. And so we started working on it. To me, it brought out one of the best parts of bouldering, which is working on something with other people. The sequence I was falling on last year, like, I think I was probably strong enough to do it, but I didn't quite have the body position right, and because I've been training with Flannery so much, we climbed together so much, she spotted it right away, and she's like, for that move, you need to do this differently. And once we did that, it just went.
I never really climbed with Kevin before. I met him a few years ago, but we had never spent much time together. He's an amazing rock climber. You know, you hear his name and you hear about some of the things he's done, free soloing, and then it's a whole other thing when you get to see it in person. He seems fearless.
It requires focus, and I really enjoy that. That's just as engaging to me as pursuing pure difficulty. My style is just to do what inspires you, whatever that is. Before I decided to come down, I just heard of the mass quantity of climbing here, like endless potential. And every time we came up to a road crew or roadside, it was just like, wow, look at all the rock out here. It's so overwhelming, really. I used to be really psyched on doing the hardest moves I can, but I don't know, something shifted in me a couple years ago where just being part of the landscape on a big, beautiful line for an instant was what really got me psyched on climbing big, tall lines. Because these things are just here all the time. But then for a moment, you can actually be a part of that landscape on this feature, not just crimping out of a cave. You're actually part of the landscape for a second when you're on these big features. I'm becoming more and more aware that I make people uncomfortable. And I don't really know what to do about it. Maybe reassure them that I wouldn't be doing it if I didn't feel in control. And maybe I could have done that a little better on this trip.
Kevin's just nuts. Watching Kevin climb is like watching a train wreck sometimes, except for he's really calm and everyone else is freaking out.
He's very analytical and he prepares things very well. He makes sure that there's no loose rock and he chalks it up and he rehearses it. And he seems to try to control the situation as much as he can.
My style is just doing whatever inspires me at the moment and not letting anything else cloud that. So if it's a big, easy, beautiful line, so be it. If it's something at my personal limit, great.
My first thought is just like, what is he doing? That is insane. I mean, it's just totally crazy. He has so much confidence in his ability that climbing 5'11 or 5'12 or even harder maybe off the deck is not an issue for him. And that's really impressive that he can shut his mind off and do that.
I'd say that aesthetics drive all of my climbing motivation. The feature is what appealed to me. It's not just a line of holds. It's an entire like teardropped ship's prow.
I've lived in Wyoming all my life. I suppose I would call myself a cowboy. You know, I don't wear Wranglers every day or a cowboy hat every day, but it's more of a way of life.
I think the climbing really matters to him. He really enjoys it. He doesn't care what people think of him or if they think he's great or famous or anything else. In the continuum of lander climbers over the years, Dussel and Greg Collins and Skinner and Paul Piana, BJ represents the next step forward in technical ability and red pointing, being a much stronger climber than any of those guys were. BJ is a professional carpenter, and it makes me laugh when I see these guys in their sponsored gear, and this guy's like buying his shoes and climbing on 20-year-old quick draws.
My schedule the last couple years has been working through the summer, September, October off, and then back to work, and then usually take February and March off.
He's developed his entire climbing style around the rock here.
The Wild Iris is a really cool area. It's just this bone white dolomite, and it's incredibly clean and incredibly solid rock. It tends to be kind of small, like short, steep features, but a really fun, powerful style with lots of small 1 and 2 finger pockets. And it's pretty expansive. There's a lot of that type of rock up there. You know, going through the moves with confidence is difficult because you're just not sure when it's going to be too much. You don't know exactly what your fingers can take, and when you go too far, it's really bad. You could call it rowdy. Yeah, pain tolerance is an issue, I guess. Just because you're pulling on tiny, tiny holds. Like, you're definitely gritting your teeth and bearing down on some tiny holds. Like, the movement is really good, but the holds are pretty heinous because they're all small one-finger pockets and whatnot. Like, that little two-finger crimp pocket on Genetic Drifter really comes to mind. It's a really good boulder problem, but it's not really fun, so that makes it difficult to really push yourself when you're scared the whole time that you might hurt your fingers.
I started rock climbing in Cody when I was about 14, and shortly after that I moved to Lander and met, you know, Todd Skinner and Steve Bechtel and Bobby Modell, and we become friends, and they've been a tremendous influence on me. You're just out with your friends and, you know, drinking cheap beer and shooting guns and cutting down trees and having big fires. Yeah, that's what cowboys do when they go rock climbing.
Genetic Drifter is a really special route. It's hard to even say how long I've been trying that route because I've been climbing on the pieces of it for so long. That first crux is so hard for me that I only get through it once or twice a summer. It's also a really special route because it's kind of the culmination of all the climbing on that wall. And there's a few places that you get to a good hold and you can kind of take a deep breath and slow down a little bit and maybe chalk one hand, but there's nowhere that you're really hanging and shaking out. What's that? What's that? Remind me of. What's that? Remind me of. It must be love. What's that? What's that? Remind me of. What's that? Remind me of. It must be love. La, la, la.
top it out, Wendling.
Oh my God!
Yeah! Oh,
yeah!
That was awesome.
Oh my God! Holy cow!
I'm Nalle Hukkataivo from Helsinki, Finland. I'm 23 years old and I was born here in Helsinki. And I guess this is what I still consider home, but most of the year I just spend traveling around the world. Being a professional rock climber, it's enough to keep a roof over my head. And I mean, for me, it's more important to be able to travel and climb around the world. I mean, I like my place, it's decent and good enough to live in 2 or 3 months out of the year, so worked for me. That's what I want.
Welcome to Boulder Care Scoop, Mr. Hukkataivo. I hope you enjoy your training session.
Well, the climbing scene in Finland isn't that big yet, but it's growing really fast. Finland, it's pretty flat. There's no mountains here, really. Lots of lakes. In the winter, it's super cold. Summer, it's pretty warm for climbing, and fall, it rains a lot.
Don't need a reason to do the things that I do. No need to impress you, just wanna undress you. I really love your shoes, used to kick kangaroos. And the way you comb your hair like it's 1982. I don't live to break the rules, I just wanna make you drool. Cause baby I come equipped with every kind of tool. A midnight interlude, I'll lick your attitude. Until your face turns blue, until your face turns blue.
I hope no one German is gonna see this.
You know how we do. You know how we do. You know how we do. This is how we do. You know how we do.
today we are going to do some bridge jumping.
Hello, I'm Reetta from Finland.
I'm Debbie McGill from Finland.
So, Nalle, what are you going to do now?
Well, we're going to jump off the bridge and going to do the test jump and hope everything's fine. Then we can start throwing some other people off from the bridge.
Ihan pitäis ottaa. Varmaan parikyt vielä, en mä tiedä paljon siitä lähti.
Mut ai siis mitä, ette, ai tota kuinka pitkälle paljon
sä hyppäät? Paljon tässä on löysää, niin.
Mut eikö se, mitä, mistä sä voit tuntea se, mitä jos siinä on liikaa löysää?
Ei kyllä se tuntee, kun se kiristyy tätä vasta.
There's a leisure class at both ends of the socioeconomic spectrum. You can have a lot of money and no time, or a little money and a lot of time. And it's very, very fun to be on either end of it. My name is Rick Oliver. I live in Corey Dwan's camper, as I have for the last 10 years. I don't think you have to be broke to be a good climber. I think it's just the choice that people make. More time off, less money, and they make it work. That's what I do. I think that's what most people do.
Please don't wait for me. I lost my way again.
When you drive into Waco, just cruise along the front side road and watch the endless little crevasses of West Mountain cruise by. And to me, when I see that, it's just the embodiment of potential.
When I was young, I dreamed of a life that had freedom, that had joy.
The first time I came here was on a college trip, and they didn't have a crash pad, so I hiked up to the boulders with a little cushion from a couch, and I strapped that on my back with my climbing gear, and that was my pad.
Matt's style of bouldering, he's long and lean. He likes to jump and grab tiny, tiny grips, and he pulls down on them really hard. He's a phenomenal rock climber. Not only is he climbing on small grips and putting up mad problems, he gives a lot back. He's out here guiding kids, randoms, all kinds of people.
After doing a guidebook, I really started getting more involved in finding new problems and developing first ascents. Commercial 303 to headquarters.
607 headquarters.
R20 is West Mountain.
1022, these are climbers.
Waco is a great place because for first ascents, because the rock really lends itself to imaginative climbing, and so you kind of have to be creative about where the line can go or what can go. And the style of climbing here is also really intricate and interesting. So from a first ascent perspective, no one's ever tried these moves before, so you have to figure them out.
Watch me here.
You become attached to the climb and you want to be the first one to do it. And if you have to leave that, that means someone else could come by and do it.
Come on! Woo!
In general, I like problem solving, and I like problem solving in climbing, and it's fun to figure something out that has never been addressed before, and you can do that with the first ascent.
When I'm talking to him about a topic, like other than climbing, he's pretending that he's listening to me. And then I look at him and I think he's paying attention to me, but he's really focused, like he's just looking somewhere else.
Would you find yourself bolting it if this wasn't here?
What's that?
Would you find yourself bolting it if this wasn't here? And if it wasn't in Waco?
Maybe.
The crux section involves this really small pocket that has kind of a sharp edge on it, and then a small crimper that you just have to dig into. And those holds definitely tax the skin. It's definitely possible if you were not careful and you were just gunning for it, grabbing those holds and pulling too hard on them, you could certainly slice your skin.
Yeah.
It's a really cool moment when you've finally figured out all the moves on a problem and you know what to do, and then you know that all you need to do at that point is link them together. I try not to get too attached to things I'm working on. You want to do something and going home without success is hard, but it also just makes you psyched to get back out and come back and do it. Today is my fourth day on the problem, and today is also my last day in Waco, so I'm hoping to do it as well.
How'd it feel?
It kind of felt the same as it did yesterday, the first try.
Yeah.
I think Matt's a super smart guy, and he is very calculated. He's very efficient. He doesn't mess around. He doesn't waste a lot of time. He gets it done. That's just his style. That's his personality. That's his mathematical genius, always going.
I like to work through moves. That's probably the aspect of the sport that I like the most, is just like working an individual move or figuring out how to climb past like a little section of rock. Just that sort of like mystery, especially on first ascents or new routes, where it's completely unknown whether or not that section of rock can be climbed. So that's really enjoyable for me.
Here we go. Come on.
Come on, Matt.
Come on, man, come on. Come on. Come on, yeah.
Come on!
This is Come on! This is it! Awesome, awesome, come on! Come on! Come on, Matt!
Vengo da una famiglia che ha forti origini montane. Tutti i miei parenti, praticamente tutti arrampicano, tutti hanno a che fare con la montagna. Io ho iniziato a scalare a, penso, 3 anni, quando ho iniziato a camminare e ho anche iniziato a scalare. Per me è sempre stato un gesto estremamente naturale, come qualsiasi altra cosa che potrebbe fare un bambino a quell'età.
It's one of the best thing you can do, to find a piece of rock you like and nobody has ever climbed it. You don't know how to climb it. You have to find a way out.
When I was doing World Cups 5 years ago, we were hitchhiking the comps. We were sleeping on couches, sleeping in cars, camping. We met up with Lucas en route to Sassofortino. And judging from Lucas's place, I think things have changed.
I started competing at the age of 12, and I'm not sure that I can buy another Ferrari with the money I'm making now.
Ciao Greccio!
Ciao Greccio!
Come va?
Bene, tu?
La situazione è che ogni tanto non c'ho voglia di allenarmi in palestra, allora rimango a casa, magari mi incontro con Cody, cazzeggiamo un po', stiamo lì, ci beviamo qualche cosa e se viene fuori qualche linea fuori di casa facciamo 2 blocchi sotto il tetto, robe così, giusto per organizzare.
The Italian lifestyle, it's quite a friendly lifestyle, I think the people have a really cool, friendly, happy way of living. The Italians are very go-lucky as a culture. The bouldering in Italy got better each day. The first day we arrived in Tuscany, everything was completely wet due to weeks of fog. With each day it got sunnier and the conditions just kept on getting better and better, and we kept on finding more and more boulders. And the ambience in the chestnut trees was really amazing.
My heart's in a cage and it's ready to fly.
paper, but the damage is done. I really think it's over. You broke my heart and you've had your fun. It's too late, you don't deserve a last warning.
That's what she said.
Every night we were eating gnocchi with tartufo and porcini, pizza with porcini, tagliatelle with porcini, penne with porcini.
I'm going to buy some food for tomorrow, some local cheese and some meat. Here they have really good meat in Tuscany.
We are in Italy, so the pizzerias, you know, we're in the country of the pizza, so they are always good. Here in Sasso Fortino, I'm a local, yeah.
Michele Caminati is really talented, Boulder from Parma, Italy. He's a mathematics student. He's got really, really good muscle memory. If he does a move one time, he can do it for sure again and again and again.
Michele Caminati è un mio amico. Rompichiamo insieme da un sacco di tempo. Siamo tutti e due facciamo parte del team della nazionale d'arrampicata. Quindi lo conosco da quando siamo dei bambini. E ci capita spesso di andare a arrampicare insieme, ci alleniamo insieme. Succede tutto in maniera molto naturale.
Near Parma, where he grew up, there were two bouldering areas, Ceriola and Lagoni. And you can see that bouldering so much at those places has definitely left a big influence on his climbing style.
Maybe you can spend many times trying, many days trying, and when you get to know the trick to do it, it's special. Of yourself, everybody can come and try. You put a piece of yourself into the rock.
Wow.
Caffè italiano buonissimo. Poi Hollywood no caffè buono.
I guess a typical day for me, I start things out slow because things get really fast really quick, so it's pretty slow living out here in Eldo. It's morning coffee, it's gathering my thoughts, it's walking the dogs, it's playing some music. And then, you know, it's full on, it's organizing shoots, it's writing proposals, it's writing grants, it's submitting photos, it's shooting a ton, it's lining up shoots, it's full bore, full go, you know, until I can stop and eat dinner. And it couldn't be more exciting. It couldn't be more special. Like, I feel so blessed and so lucky to have so many friends out there and so many people that have me along to shoot with them. And my life just seems to be an adventure, like day to day. My name is Andy Mann, and I live in El Dorado Springs, Colorado, and I'm a professional photographer. You know, when I'm up there and I'm shooting, you know, with Matt, I can tell these times that he goes into this problem-solving stuff. You can see it in his calculations. Everything from like the tips of his shoes to his gear placement to the weather, how he's rested and let up, what he's eaten. He's not the biggest, strongest guy, but he's the smartest. My field of research is cognitive science with an emphasis on computer science, machine learning, probabilistic models, and basically building models to explain cognition. The myth about Matt Wilder being able to solve a Rubik's Cube in 20 some seconds and make money at it, I don't think that ever happened.
Solving the Rubik's Cube, less than 30 seconds. Mix it up as much as you want. Here, come mix it up.
There's no way. I mean, I've spent so many hours trying to do this. 30 seconds, that's not possible.
I really enjoy the hunt for a new line and the process of developing it. It requires a lot of problem-solving ability and also requires a lot of creativity.
To be able to take that kind of problem solving and use it on rock climbing is like, it's truly one of his tools, you know? Matt's project is so amazing because it's on the north face of the Devil's Thumb, which is hands down the sickest formation on the Front Range. His vision to be able to see this line and to think it goes on gear and to, you know, to have the kahunas to get up there and start attempting this thing is truly amazing. He likes the pressure, he likes to perform, like, he likes to, you know, put the stakes on it, you know, no matter if that's like, you know, personal physical risk or what it is, he likes the stakes high.
From most places around Boulder, if you look up, you can see the thumb just sort of silhouetted against the sky. It's pretty high up and it's just a really beautiful rock face. And as you get up closer to it, if you hike up there, you realize that it's really has this incredible steep overhanging face, and just it's just really awe-inspiring. And the view from up there is just as incredible as, you know, looking at it from down below. The route has definitely a few sections that are dangerous. The first 40 feet really doesn't have much good gear, and so you're doing, you know, 512 minus moves that are technical enough that you have to be really careful and you wouldn't want to blow it. You have some gear that might hold, but it's not the kind of place you'd want to fall. So that's the most dangerous part of the route. Idea of completing a route in a style that's good. I like the focus that's required when you actually get to the point of going for the lead and getting your mind into the correct state and really controlling your body movements in a way that's not allowing much room for error. The upper part of the route also has some sections that are scary, but not necessarily dangerous. Because the route's so overhanging, I think a fall from the upper section would be mostly a clean fall into space. Nevertheless, it's kind of scary, and some of the gear near the top is marginal, and those last moves where you're pulling up the final head wall and then mantling over onto the slab definitely are heady.
This year I've spent maybe like 2 months at home. I can't even remember the last time I've been there. I don't really feel pressure from my sponsors or from anyone else really. It's just like trying to push my own limits and trying to evolve as a climber. From like a year ago, I was still mainly repeating stuff. If I was pushing my limits, I was just like repeating hard stuff. During the past 1 year, maybe I just tried to like put more time into first ascents, like put up harder problems. The next step is kind of putting up new hard problems during first ascents. Putting first ascents is way different from repeating stuff. When you go and try to repeat a hard problem, it's like you know that it goes. I mean, it's been done by another climber, another human being. But when you're doing first ascents at your limit, you, first of all, you don't know if it actually goes. I mean, of course, you try to think positive. It's like, okay, I can do this. But in reality, you really don't know if you can actually do it. I mean, there's so much good climbing here. You're free to go wherever, try whatever. In the morning, when you wake up and just go bouldering, it's pretty much as good as it gets. The last season I just went hiking around on my rest days for like hours and hours, just looking for new stuff. Project Real Big is one of like the most obvious lines, like a super obvious arete, tall. It's just like one of those things you see, like you just have to climb it. Took me a lot of days to do it. Every single move just individually, like on top rope. And I started trying with pads from crown up. I wasn't even getting like 2 meters off the crown.
That's a f***ing hard move.
No!
And like at that point I realized that linking every single one of those moves together, it's gonna be a lot of work. I was here for like 7 weeks, and at that point I was thinking, like, is that even gonna be enough?
We'll be right back.
45-minute hike up there. You have to organize pads and people to go up there to carry pads for you. Like, if you fall from 8 meters, even if you have a lot of pads, it could be bad.
There's a really, really scary last move where you have to do a high step up here. And really hope you don't fall, because that will be a long way down.
Come on.
It's good.
Come on.
Yeah, come on! Yes. Nah, come on! Yes! Great, super nice.
The first time I actually linked it from the bottom to what I thought was the crux, I was like super psyched and like I had the top pretty dialed on top rope.
Come on.
At that point I started realizing that the actual crux, the red point crux, is up at like 8 meters. Like the very, very last move is the red point crux of the whole problem.
Come on. Oh, fuck! Ah! Oh, fuck!
Great.
Oh, man! Ah! Oh. No! Oh. Fuck! Why?
Being a professional rock climber is maybe not as glorious as most people would think.
Knallehucke voll. No, I know Nalle from the World Cup competitions and the Rockmaster, and I also met him a couple of times climbing the rock. The first time I heard about Airstar was when I talked to my friend Cody, who mentioned that very old line and project in the roadside sector. A couple of people had tried it before. The first time I went there to try it myself, I went with Bernie Fiedler from Austria, a good friend of mine, and he's also a very dynamic and strong climber. Nalle also went there to have a couple of tries, and they couldn't do the crux move, which is a really far dynamic move. Yeah, I got psyched, I got interested, and I knew that this problem might fit my style. I'm Kilian Fischer and I'm from Innsbruck in Austria. The first time I tried the project with Bernie, we tried feeling the holes and have a look if the move is possible at all, because we were not sure if you could do it or not. So we tried jumping really high, and we also tried this leg swing, this like ninja tactics.
Yeah.
I think it's a very fitting name, because if you do the problem, if you do the scratch move, you really fly through the air like an air star, and it makes you feel like a pilot. Progress came like by chance. I tried it a couple of times, and then I saw that I can gain more height. And one day I realized that the move is possible. It was an honor for me to add a new problem to this famous climbing area. The most important thing for me was just to do this perfect, beautiful line. If you know Nale, you know he is a really silent person. He doesn't talk too much about his projects and about his climbing. But he told us that he had found this really beautiful new area with this new boulder. So one day we decided to go there and have a look at it. And it was really impressive. I mean, it's just huge red with no holes on it, and he told us that the crux is the very top part of the boulder. When I saw Nale the first time on this, working on this problem, he fell really high on the problem. I knew that his trip would come to an end very fast, and there were just some days left where he could try it, so I doubted it actually if he could do it.
Come on!
Yeah, cool. Yeah.
After discovering like new micro beta for the last move, it took me like 3 days just to get up there again. Just to figure out if it works on the right point.
No, there's no point even trying. The left hand is just already like sliding off before I even move my hand.
One day we got really good conditions. It was a cloudy day, really windy. Everything was pretty much perfect, except I had been working on the project for so many days. Like I wasn't really feeling super fresh, but the conditions were so good that there was like no way not to use that. We only had 4 pads, which was not a lot for that problem. Like on the best days we had like 10.
Scheiße.
But it's just like if you like some small tiny thing, everything goes to hell.
Yeah. Don't think about it if you f*** up anything. No. Just keep on climbing.
Nale, he's ridiculous. He has so much power. He's super psyched and he climbs all the time, every day. And it's inspiring to see what he can do. He tries really hard, and I'm just impressed. He's just super talented. He might be the strongest climber in the world.
Come on, Nale.
Come on, Nolly.
Yeah, that was probably the best feeling ever in climbing for me.
Do you think it gets much better?
Oh, I don't really see it getting much better.
Oh man, good job.
Wow.
It, man. Yes.
Yeah, you can tell it is heading.
Woohoo! Oh my god.
I know that some people know that, yeah, it will be my way of life. Climbing, I won't describe myself as being talented at the beginning because my first experience wasn't that great at all. But it was like something unknown, the whole, even the whole professional world. I can't even speak about it because at this time it was so far away for us. It was like just maybe possible for some people in France or maybe some German like Gulisch and co. Okay, it may sound a bit strange, but it was never my goal to be in front of the scene and so on, searching for new difficulty for everybody, for the whole world of climbing. It was like it was my own way, and I was looking at something new in some ways, and it was not so new because some people were climbing really hard, it seems like, before me and before many other people. When you climb since years and so, is for sure your physical ability or body is changing, that's it. When I was a teenager, I was really skinny and really flexible, less muscle, really strong finger and so. It was nice to discover a type of climb where I could, without this aspect of fear, just think about the climbing, the rock and myself and the movement. It's my life, and I don't want to be restricted by it should be sport climbing, it should be bouldering, it should be a traverse. If I want to climb that or that, it can be anything. If it's a line like Kinamden, for me it's a great line. It's a great line. It was the first thing I saw in this cave, it was this possibility of doing that. You start as a bouldering, even sit down, and after you finish with a rope, but yeah, it's great. I think everything is open. We have all this possibility. I don't expect any judge behind me to tell that's right, that's wrong, or so. Discovering still, I think it's one of the last adventure in climbing, which make it not just like a sport. The sport aspect is great, but I think it's very creative too, and it's a bit more than just a physical activity. Climbing is a big part of my life, so I am a climber first. It's not like I am a professional climber. If you ask me, somebody is asking me, what are you, I will say that I am a climber mostly, so, but not professional. It won't be my first word. What makes climbing so great is that it's not rules given from the human being, so it's given from the nature, so there are as many possibilities as there are rocks on this planet. We'll be right back.
world started to round. With the turning of the sun, cities rose from towns, quiet turned to sound. But that place stayed the same. That's Wyoming. So the legends say that explorers tried to explain but the beauties that they found just too much to write down. And so it's fiction they believe. Just smells remain, and I know Adams never seen such a scene, in neither Eden or his dream. Even Eve would stop and stare. God's most perfect square. If there's one thing I believe, he made Wyoming. Sunny day can quickly turn to rain, but we don't mind because all of the sweetest smells remain. Yeah. All the years hang on the wind above this last good plot of land. Hear it echo in the trees. I hear its whisper on my knees. Or even dust can't be a king.
Well, I guess that's the end of the movie.
thanks to your contributions, I've decided to retire once again. I've bought a small estate in Tuscany. Arrivederci.